I should say, when I studied Agamas, his compassion shook me. The kind of a time it takes to set the context about everything and the detailing. If somebody comes and asks me, oh, how do you know it is written by Sadashiva? I'll say, when you read this, how he makes you feel he knows you thoroughly, this itself is possible only by a person who has achieved Sadashivatva. Nobody else can make you feel so relevant. And even when you read, you know, he knows your inner space, what all you are going through thoroughly. Anybody who has written this has already achieved Sadashivatva. So I know it is done by Sadashiva. The strength of the scripture makes you feel grateful, doesn't frighten you. See, there are some books, if you read, it will frighten you. Once you finish reading, it will frighten you and force you to do what it says. But if you finish reading Agama, you will be in love with him. Actually, whenever you fall in love with him, first decision you will take is, let me be integrated to him. It always makes you fall in love with him, and with that love you decide, let me be integrated to him. And then you start operating from that love and integrity.
Sorry.
See, otherwise, I'm telling you, anybody who stumbles upon this kind of ability to manifest powers, always try to become dictatorial and put themselves, never shows the source. But the way he made me fall in love with him, the way he made me feel I should be integrated to him, I always make sure not only me, even my generations are slave to him. And the source is remembered and reminded to people. Every time the source is reminded, somehow he is able to make people fall in love with him by his compassion. The amount of time and energy he spends on elaboration. I should give you some of the chapters which we recently translated on this third eye. The considerations he does, and then the precisely explaining with the context. Yes.
Swamiji, the way you explain makes me feel to integrate with you, Swamiji. It's amazing. I got two things.
See, I received Agama from Arunagiri Yogeshwara. I neither had time nor had the opportunity to study elaborately. It is like if he talks to me 10 words, like a 1 terabyte material will get downloaded into my brain, like one blast. For example, he talks about the yoga pada of Kamika Agama. And he will explain 2-3 asanas. By the time, like a lightning, something will happen in my system. When he explains the 7th, 8th asana, I know all the 700 he is talking about. I'll just feel he can talk, I can refer it from my mind and compare, understand. That is the way I received. And now, fortunately, by many devotees' help, we are able to collect all of that. And when I collected more and more, I am able to clearly see how I can transmit that to all you guys. See, I myself did not receive a systematic Gurukul education. I was taught by Arunagiri Yogeshwara, who just downloaded everything. Now, for example, few days before, in the last batch Nityananda Yogam participants, I was sitting and explaining the whole science of Navagrahas. Sadashiva talks about Navagrahas elaborately. The whole science I was explaining, and I know I am talking from Agama, and after explaining, I told them, but still I have not got the original book in my hand. If I get it, I can make this as a syllabus to my balasans. In 1 week, somebody brought and gave the original 7 volumes. Some old book collector, he sent it as a gift. Now we made that into syllabus for Gurukul, because when I want to teach to the teachers, for example, if I want to teach only to you guys who are going to be benefited, you will not ask me Agama reference. The moment I say Agama, you will say, that's all Swamiji, enough, I don't need any other reference. But when I want you to go and teach to others, I need the book. I need the source. I need the source. Last 2.5 years only, we started working on that line. Collecting the source. Now fortunately we have a team also, is translating. A team is translating. Janardhan is expanding the team now. We are entering into the expansion of maybe 200 people. We are looking at making it in 200 people. Continuously translating. More and more. English, from Sanskrit to English. Sanskrit to English. Actually what we want, you know, as of now we have collected 3 terabyte material on Agamas. We want to translate everything and freely upload in the website, in the internet. So anybody wants, they can practice. They can practice, do research, learn. It's like we have taken it up in a large scale. Already one team is working, but now we are going to expand it to 200 people. That work is also going on, side by side. When I study this whole thing, I only understand the compassionate consideration our masters carry for human beings. Nowhere threatening is used. Even their marketing is such mild romantic marketing. I should use the word romantic marketing. The whole marketing is such romantic marketing. Even that looks so cute. No, you just know an innocent guy is marketing. It is so beautifully presented, so compassionately presented, and so much of considerations are taken about the human beings and the problems human beings may face in the future. All these are openly discussed. And Sadashiva, after discussing all these, he says, after all these detailed discussions, he comes to a conclusion. Then it is no more he instructing, he is taking all of us into his confidence. And then he is saying, shall we do this now? And he is creating a certain space. That is why I want to say, it is not book, it is a process. He is creating certain space and then evolving it. So even for this whole process, I need to create a certain space where we have a lot of small talk. See, yesterday whole day what I did is only small talk. If you just go through the whole session yesterday, I sat 10 hours with you guys. What I did? Nothing. Hardly I spoke about the main subject maybe for 1 hour. See, only 1 hour I spoke about the main subject, but we sat 10 hours. If you see the whole timing, we sat together 10 hours. How much time I took class? 1 hour. It is just entanglement, chilling, sitting, casually taking and looking. So I am letting you guys see how I am eating, how I am sitting, how I am chatting with my kids, or how I am administering, settling down, zeroing down the distance. Then context setting. Only then powers can be awakened. See, by putting the gun on the neck, you can't, by putting the gun on the head, you can't awaken the powers. You can make somebody terrorist by putting the gun on the neck. Hey, go and kill, or you will be killed. That is too easy. terrorist manuals can be written very easily. Fanatic production manuals can be written very easily. But agamas are a process. These are written to develop a very subtle grooves in your brain which completely keeps you awakened, which keeps you fully alive. But convincing somebody, come on, come to this state, you will be blissful, you will manifest all these powers, is not a joke. A subtle grooves in the brain need to develop. This whole book, I can see his tremendous love and consideration for what goes on inside us. Especially when he describes, you will feel as if he is sitting in front of you and reading your mind. How many of you feel in the satsang, I am talking directly to you? That is what exactly I felt when I read Agamas. He is talking precisely to us. That feeling he is able to generate. I can say that is the life thread of Agamas. Yes, please pick up the mic. Give the mic.
So Swamiji, I'm sure the old temples were all complying with this.
Actually, all temples are built by each Agama. For example, Thiruvannamalai temple, just reading the Karana Agama, I can give you the whole plan of Thiruvannamalai temple. I don't need to go there. I don't need Google map. I can tell you which pillar will be in which side, what deity will be carved on that pillar. I can give you sitting here in Karana Agama. Same way Madurai temple, Kamika Agama. Same way Tirupati temple, there is Agama. In Vaishnavism, Pancharatra, Vaiganasa, two Agamas. So each temple is built precisely by Agamas, and each temple develops its own patadi to run the temple, to operate the temple.
But are the modern Hindu temples in accordance with Agama?
No, unfortunately.
So there's a lot of potential there.
All modern Hindu temples are social gathering places, not the place where God lives.
So this is so important. This knowledge is so.
See, for example, I myself dictate. You build my house like this. Only if you build like that, I will come and stay. Yes. If not, my memories can stay. You can celebrate my memory.
Right.
But if you want me to come and stay, it has to be as I instructed.
So this is something that the leaders of Hinduism today
need to know.
All the leaders of Hinduism basically going around giving all kind of events and lectures and talks and so on. But if they don't understand Agama, then that is some kind of a postmodern Hinduism which they got.
And one more thing, as on now, other than Agama, no other book has a detailed instructions about building temple. In Vedas, we had a part called Sthapatya Veda, which is lost. Available temple construction science means only Agama we have.
Also, what about worship at home? Is it Agama's?
Yes, yes, yes. Even that, Sadashiva gives an elaborate description.
What about marriage ceremony?
Yes, all the 36 rituals, the Annaprasna, Garbhadana, everything he gives detailed description.
My guess is that most Hindu marriages, at least in US that I have attended, have nothing to do with Agama. They just
nothing to do with Hinduism.
Nothing to do with Hinduism. Yeah.
Actually, Hindu marriage is a ritual done to the Kuladevata. You can't have non-veg and alcohol there.
Right.
You see, in all Hindu marriage, the Kuladevata is invoked. You can't have non-veg and alcohol. The moment you bring non-veg and alcohol, it is no more Hindu marriage. The 3 days, the sankalpa is done and the kanganam is tied. And after the marriage, after the honeymoon only, that thread is removed. From that day tying and the last day, you see, the context of Hindu marriage and the context of Western bachelor party. See, from tomorrow you have to be committed to one girl, so today enjoy, is the bachelor party. In Hinduism, before the marriage, the fellow is supposed to be the vrakta, means the renunciate, and he should run away to Kashi. The daughter's father should go and bring him from Kashi and get him married. No, really. How many of you know in intermarriage, the Kashi Yatra is there. Means, he has understood everything about life. Now he wants to be in the space of enlightenment. Then the daughter's father says, so you are such a great being. Please, person like you should reproduce and create, keep the generations alive. Please, for that sake, come and marry. And the mantra says, for the sake of keeping the dharmika sampradaya alive, I give my daughter to you.
So, Swamiji, I wonder what the law has to say, because there is a Hindu law.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder if anybody has challenged that a lot of Hindu law is not being, the so-called Hindu law which they have is not really Hindu.
See, basically, the apex body of Hinduism is Akada Parishad and Kashi Pandit Vidwat Sabha. These two accept Veda and Agamas as a revealed scripture. But further work of making it legitimate, nobody has done it. Maybe we will have to take it up.
We have to do it.
We have to take it up.
We have to do it.
See, the Hindu Marriage Act, all that should be designed from this. The context of marriage itself is different. Yes.
Swamiji, it's a famous saying, singer, not the song.
Sing?
Singer, not the song.
Mm-mm-mm.
You made it. I mean, the way you explain it is amazing.
Nityananda Swami.
Swamiji.
Now, let me finish here. Please go ahead.
Two things. One is you touched the subject about this comparison of agama with the other, which is actually, there is no comparison at all. The second thing is, yesterday you touched about this, how the authors, how they, what they do is take few truths, mix it with lot of garbage.
Not only that, no, the truth is also half translated and whole thing is lost. You see, basically, they don't take some truth which is self-effulgent, Swayam Prakasa. They take some statement which cannot be refuted.
Right.
See, the philosophy building itself starts with which can't be refuted, and then it goes on into that line of, because it can't be refuted, I have a right to exist. Ours is, because I'm contributing, I have a right to exist.
Yes, sir.
See, the context is, because I can't be refuted, I have a right to exist. No. Ours is, because I am contributing, I have a right to exist. Whether it's a personality, or the book, or the theory, or the theology, or the truth. Because I am contributing, I have a right to exist. Not because I can't be refuted, so I have a right to exist. The whole context is different.